Swati, we should start now.
Yes, it's 3 o'clock. I think we can start now. A very good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this webinar organized by FICCI Cascade on combating counterfeiting and smuggling during the COVID-19 pandemic and beyond. To begin the proceedings of the day, I would request Mr. Anil Rajput, Chairman FICCI Cascade, to please make the welcome remarks.
Dr. O.P. Mishra, Joint Commissioner of Police Economic Offences Wings, Delhi Police. Mr. Deep Chand, Advisor, FICCI Cascade, and former Special Commissioner, Delhi Police. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, we can hear you. We can hear you, sir.
There is a lot of noise.
If I can request all the participants to please keep their mics on mute. I think we are getting some echo from one or two of the participants. Requesting all participants to keep their mics on mute, please.
Mr. Yes, Deep Chand, Advisor, FICCI Cascade, and former Special Commissioner, Delhi Police, distinguished guests, participants, and friends. Good afternoon. These are somber times. Times when the entire world is grappling with the COVID-19 pandemic, when mankind is pitted against an invisible and unknown adversary, whose power and potential have brought the entire planet to its knees. And what makes it particularly unsettling is what we have no idea whether the worst is over or it is yet to come. Clearly, the numbers are frightening, and social and economic impact of COVID-19 is going to reinvent our thought process and mindset and reset the manner in which businesses are conducted world over. It is also true that we, as difficult as it sounds, have to find our way through all of this and learn to live and conduct our professional activities in this hostile environment. As it is said, life has to go on. It is in this backdrop that we've decided to have this webinar on combating counterfeiting and smuggling during the COVID-19 pandemic and beyond. Well before the COVID-19 pandemic, we at FICCI Cascade have been drawing the attention of the world on the absolute detrimental impact of illicit trade on the societies and economies across the world. Just like COVID-19, illicit trade knows no color, no religion, and has no mercy world over. It is a faceless enemy which only destroys whatever it touches. This similarity between COVID-19 and illicit trade is indeed horrifying and should be the reason enough for us not to lower our guards even in these challenging times. Let us look at some basic numbers. Illicit trade is the world's largest growing industry, and its size is estimated to range between 6.5 million to 3 trillion, according to multiple studies. It represents 10% of the global trade. It is also the source of funding for many terrorist organizations, which use the proceeds from the counterfeiting and smuggling to give shape to their sinister agendas and create destabilization world over. It was way back in 2011, Mr. P.C. Jha and Deep Chand, three of us, actually started this initiative along with FICCI and dedicated a forum for establishing the Committee Against Smuggling and Counterfeiting Activities, the Strong Economy, which in short we call Cascade. Its objective was to generate awareness of its detrimental impact amongst the consumers and the citizens, capacity building for the law enforcement agencies, including judges, policies, and customs officers, research and proposing law reforms, enforcement of IP-related laws, sharing of best practices world over for combating illicit trade, provide knowledge base to the industry members, and much more. And I must say that we have traversed over the years a long journey, and we continue to work hard in our endeavor. We at FICCI has always stressed on the importance of unabated and collective effort if we were to control and damage caused by the illicit trade. Therefore, while many genuine businesses have been hampered during the past few months, there is no doubt in my mind that all those indulging in counterfeiting and smuggling are looking at this unpleasant situation as an opportunity to flood markets with illicit products. And I'm sure all of you must have already seen and read many reports emanating on this issue. These people want to actually exploit the slowdown in production and supply of genuine products, thereby creating many more problems for consumers and authorities alike. I'm confident that if enforcement agencies and authorities step up their vigil,
I think Mr. Rajput has lost the connection.
Yeah, I'm back again.
So it's back. Yeah.
Yes.
I'm confident that if enforcement agencies and authorities step up their vigil, there will be a much greater seizures. And I'm sure that these difficult times and manpower is at premium. However, by using superior skills and greater reliance on technology, our enforcement agencies will ensure that these counterfeiters and smugglers do not exploit the current situations, and that our people and genuine producers are kept off harm's way. Last but not the least, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to each and everyone for accepting our invitation. And I'm sure that our thinking hats in place, illicit trade will be countered effectively in the days and months ahead. And I'd like to once again thank everybody. Thank you very much, and over to Swati.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Mr. Deep Chand, advisor FICCI Cascade and former Special Commissioner of Police, New Delhi, to make his address, please.
Thank you, Swati. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Minus in front of that particular.
I'll request, I think somebody's mic is not on mute. Request you to please keep your mics on mute.
Friends, counterfeiting and smuggling poses a serious problem, harming Indian economy and affecting our day-to-day life. During the last 20 years, the volume of counterfeiting activities has increased by 100 times. As mentioned by Mr. Rajput, the figures are enormous from various agencies who have collected figures. This is affecting the global trade very seriously. The ongoing COVID-19 pandemic has also impacted crime and illicit economies such as organized crime, terrorism, street crime, online crime, illegal market, illicit market, and smuggling. Now, police, being the primary law enforcement agency, must prepare itself to deal with this menace of counterfeiting and smuggling, in addition to the traditional crimes. However, the COVID-19 lockdowns are likely to trigger significant, if temporary, changes, as the police forces are working 24/7 to support the country's citizens who are facing unprecedented challenges. In particular, we are seeing an increase in counterfeit healthcare products, fraud, and cybercrime. This problem will only increase with respect to essential and non-essential goods as relaxations take place and normalcy is resumed. I'll briefly try to highlight some challenges police faces and how it can address them. One is capacity building in terms of skill, infrastructure, and technology amongst the law enforcement agency. It is important in improving the detection and investigation mechanism. Unfortunately, for police officers, economic offense and IP crimes are not a priority area, since they are fully occupied with the investigation of heinous crimes and law and order. It is therefore necessary to impart special knowledge to the IOs through regular capacity building programs under economic offenses. Similarly, additional manpower with the desired aptitude need to be provided in these special cells, which are located in special cell, district investigating units, economic offense wing, etc., so that they focus exclusively on the investigation of these cases. At present, it is found that the penal provisions provided in the applicable laws, such as Copyright Act and Trademark Act, are not adequate. The investigation, prosecution, and culmination of the trial takes unduly long time. These concerns need to be addressed. The punishment provided for the first offense in both these acts is imprisonment of not less than 6 months and not more than 3 years. This clause of not more than 3 years earlier used to be treated as non-bailable, and the bail was denied to the accused. Unfortunately, now some high courts have interpreted it as it is up to three years. So they are considered as bailable. So now the bail is freely available, and the deterrence that was attached to this arrest under these acts is diluted. This enables the accused to get an easy bail, and many times it is seen the criminal is back into the business, which gives an impression that the law is not deterrent enough. Stringent monetary penalty for the offenses like the Customs Act 1962, the fine under the Trademark Act and Copyright Act may be increased up to the value of the goods involved. Incidentally, the punishment under Customs Act is extended up to 7 years now. Now, retailers and wholesalers selling fake, counterfeit, and smuggled goods operate freely in many well-known parts of the national capital. Having established business over many years, Delhi's Gandhinagar, Kashmiri Gate, Palika Bazaar, Nehru Place, Ghaffar Market, and Sadar Bazaar are some markets that have been labeled as notorious markets in global piracy and rife in counterfeit selling apparel, footwear, automobiles, auto parts, electronics, leather goods, mobile phones, name anything that is desired. The enforcement authorities could take sustained and coordinated action against such notorious markets. Moreover, creating some kind of picket post in these areas, these market areas, may also be considered. In addition to the impact, like revenue loss to the industries and revenue loss to the government, health and safety issues involved due to fake drugs, fake cosmetics, auto parts. Interestingly, during the past few days, leading intelligence and law enforcement agencies in their investigation have found conclusive evidence of increasing use of the money earned through smuggling and counterfeiting in supporting the terrorist incidents. Gold, cigarette, oil, precious gems and stones, music and film DVDs, narcotics, drugs, etc. are the major contributor to financing of terrorism. FICCI Committee Against Smuggling and Counterfeiting Activities Destroying the Economy, in short we say FICCI's cascade, have been engaging with police officers in Delhi and in the other states to highlight industry issues and sensitize them on the magnitude of the crime. We have in the past organized this capacity building program to create awareness among the young police officers about this menace of counterfeiting and smuggling and to enrich their knowledge on how to deal with this crime. Business have taken a hit during the crisis of COVID-19. The current situation, which is already witnessing a severe socio-economic distress, sale of fake and smuggled health products will only worsen the problem, as the government is trying to its best to jumpstart the economy and revive business. Arresting the menace is vital, and law enforcement agencies like the police will play a defining role to eliminate this socio-economic threat. Nowadays, we are hearing the possibility of shifting of some industry from China to India in the wake of this COVID-19 and this corona problem. But again, we have to be very assuring to the industries. Then only we can expect that these industry will come to China and FDI will come to China FDI will come to India from China, or the industry will shift to India from China, because they need an assurance that their products are safeguarded, their IP is safeguarded, and for that we have to work overtime to ensure the industry globally that we can do this and we are able to provide them necessary protection. Thank you. Over to Swati.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your address. We are extremely privileged to have with us Dr. O.P. Mishra, Joint Commissioner of Police, Economic Offence Wing of the Delhi Police. Dr. Mishra is a decorated police officer, an ace investigator, effective strategist, and a tactful law and order handler with operational expertise and professional acumen in planning and executing mega security arrangements. Thank you, sir, for joining us today. And may I now request you to kindly make the keynote address.
Thank you very much, Swati. Shri Anil Rajput, Chairman FICCI Cascade. Shri Deep Chand, former Special Commissioner of Police and Advisor FICCI Cascade. Shri PC Jha, other fellow panelists. Good afternoon to all of you. Under normal circumstances, FICCI would have preferred this interaction in one of its auditorium or conference halls. COVID-19 has forced us to experiment and adopt new methods of communication and dialogue. It has similarly provided opportunity to various criminal syndicates to experiment and adopt new methodologies for committing crime. Let me first of all congratulate FICCI for choosing a very right topic for discussion today. Before I touch the topic for the day, let me present a perspective to understand both forms of crime. Famous French sociologist Durkheim considered crime as a social phenomenon. He considered crime to be a feature of all societies. He argues that crime is inevitable for two main reasons. Everyone is socialized differently, and some people may not be effectively socialized. Poor socialization means that they do not accept the shared norms and values of mainstream society, which can make them deviant. Criminals don't feel part of the mainstream society and share and develop norms for themselves, which is not in conformity with the established norms of the system. This provides us an insight to understand criminality in society. Thus, crime is committed by people who are very much part of the society. The form, nature, and methodology for committing crime have been changing with the overall growth and development of the society. For example, the unprecedented level of growth in information technology has led to emergence of ever-increasing cybercrime, which is faceless and anonymous. I personally feel that the emergence of counterfeiting and smuggling as distinct forms of crime emerged to fill the gap between demand and supply of particular things in a formal economy. The foundation of both these crimes rests on illegal means. They try to exploit the gaps existing in the formal system and raise a parallel economy. They have posed serious challenges before regulatory institutions and law enforcing agencies across the globe. Converse of both these crimes covers important areas of human necessity. We have criminal gangs which specialize in counterfeiting Indian currency and smuggling of essential goods and services. Ladies and gentlemen, the menace of counterfeiting has increased so much that it is very difficult to distinguish between genuine and fake products today. In 2018, Forbes announced that counterfeiting was the largest criminal enterprise in the world, and sale of counterfeit and pirated goods totals $1.7 trillion US per year, which is more than drugs and human trafficking. For several criminal gangs, crisis also turns into an opportunity. During crisis, criminals try to exploit the existing limitations and gaps in the enforcement strategy and demand and supply chain. Since crisis also affects the pattern of production, thereby creating a gap between demand and supply. The gap between demand and supply also facilitates and promotes counterfeiting and smuggling of goods. Let's examine this in the backdrop of the present crisis of COVID-19. The basic protocol regarding containment of COVID-19 virus rests on three important things: wearing of masks, hand sanitizers, and maintaining social distancing leading to lockdown. Now, all these three areas have seen how counterfeiting and smuggling have taken place. So let me just present before you the global scenario. In the month of March, when COVID-19 was declared a pandemic, Interpol arrested over 121 people across 90 countries in 7 days. It was able to seize counterfeit drugs with $14 billion. WHO recently claimed that the trade of illicit medicines may account for over $30 billion, especially in developing countries. This includes contaminated medicines and medicines with wrong ingredient. In the context of COVID-19, criminals have adopted a new method of smuggling drugs in the guise of surgical masks and other things. In Peru, a consignment of Peruvian-made surgical masks meant for Hong Kong was seized by the police, which found cocaine intermingled with it. Similar things were also detected in various shipments meant for China and UK by the respective law enforcement agencies. Social distancing and lockdown has restricted the movement of citizens across the globe and access to conventional mode of physical shopping. This has promoted online shopping for several products where people are becoming victims of counterfeiting. Due to increasing demand, substandard, counterfeit, and fake goods are being sold, including food articles are sold online. In the light of increasing demand, restrictions on legitimate supply channels, the demand for online products is likely to surge further during the pandemic. This pandemic has also come as an opportunity and boon for many traditional mafia-style criminal gangs like Italian one, which actually traditionally involved in the trade of counterfeit and substandard goods, including food and other products. Delhi police was able to detect cases of human trafficking during COVID-19 when persons were transported in ambulance from one state to the other state. We also detected cases of liquor smuggling during lockdown. Huge quantities of surgical masks were also seized in various parts of the country during lockdown, including Delhi and other NCR towns. Like any crisis situation, COVID-19 has posed serious challenges for interdicting capacities of law enforcement agencies. Because at present, across the globe, the law enforcing agency is also deployed in maintaining and ensuring other public safety related duties related to COVID-9 protocol. Criminal gangs are taking advantage of this diversion of the law enforcement agencies also. Has always been concerned about activities of counterfeiting and smuggling. It is due to internal surveillance at the ground level by Delhi police that we don't have any organized gang which specializes in counterfeiting and smuggling. Our specialized units keep on seizing fake Indian currency notes. On our inputs, neighboring countries have also seized huge quantities of fake Indian currency notes. FICN activities are carried out by an international network of criminals having terror links who are also involved in printing fine quality fake currency Indian notes. In the year 2019 itself, we had 41 cases of FICN detected by Delhi police. We have arrested many known criminals in this connection who had links with international terror organizations based in our neighboring countries in Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Nepal also. Although the seizure of the FICN poses a major challenge because of a very porous border between other neighboring countries. Apart from seizure of fake currency notes, we also register cases under Copyrights Act and trademark violations. In the year 2019, we registered 148 cases under Copyright Act and 61 cases under Trademark Act. In the year 2020, as of now, we have registered 25 cases under Copyright Act and 5 cases under Trademark Act. A former police officer who's also an advisor to the Fiki Cascade has just pointed out that we need to have an effective strategy for combating the menace of both this crime. And I would like to highlight few points, the strategy to combat the menace. The first point is that we have to increase surveillance at the border checkpoints, keeping in view the volume of these activities taking place across border. We also need to increase our surveillance on the known gangs by local police, wherever they are based. We also have to create public awareness. Another very important thing when we are trying to fight a menace like this, which has international ramifications, is proper coordination between law enforcement agencies, industry, and other stakeholders. There is a need to have a proper synergy so that we are on the same wavelength and page. Mr. Deepchand has really pointed out the capacity building measures which is required. We have to equip ourselves with all kinds of proper gadgets and equip ourselves with all such capacities, which is very important to fight the menace of both this crime. I think with these few words, I would just like to end my remarks on both this crime. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your very enlightening address. We have with us speakers from the industry who will highlight the issues and challenges which they are facing in the current scenario, and what role do they envisage, you know, what role they can play as a factor with the police to address this problem. I will now call upon Ms. Vijayalakshmi Malkani, IP Council of Hindustan Unilever, to make her points, please.
Thank you, Swati. I'm audible?
Yes, yes, Vijay, yeah. You are.
Okay. So, a very good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Fiki Cascade, for hosting this webinar on a topic that has great significance during COVID. I would also like to thank Mr. Anil Rajput and Mr. Deepchand for setting the context to today's webinar, and also Dr. O.P. Mishra for the insightful address. We are all aware that COVID or no COVID, the police force is always on a tireless duty. So therefore, a quick note of thanks to the entire police force for your concerted efforts in maintaining stability and order of the country, and for executing your duties with high degree of responsibility and bravery despite the risky environment. As COVID, so what I'm going to say, while it might be a reiteration of what the earlier distinguished speakers have already said, I do believe that we need to keep re-agitating these issues unless they are, until they are addressed. So therefore, with that note, as COVID continues to affect the world at an alarming pace, it is no secret that this has had severe economic implications affecting genuine businesses across the world. However, adversities also give rise to opportunities, and counterfeiters appear to have found an opportunity even during distress. While genuine businesses are struggling to get on their feet, it appears that the situation has only slightly dented the counterfeiting industry. With a growing gap in demand and supply and genuine operators out of action and existing logistical challenges for those operating with limited capacity, the situation has provided an easy fodder for counterfeiters to churn out fake goods ranging from PPE, masks, sanitizers, hand washers, disinfectants, and medicines, and create a bogus supply chain, thus posing a major risk to health and safety of the consumers. News articles from March till date continue to report cases of such illegal operations, which have been successfully busted by the police and state authorities. While these continue to pose a high risk to health and safety of consumers in an era of health scare, the brand owners continue to be severely hit by this continuing menace. It appears as if nothing has changed for these counterfeiters, and it is business as usual. While we are aware that counterfeiting of essentials like sanitizers and disinfectants are rampant, the current situation and restrictions has further hampered our efforts in tackling the same. Since the work done by investigating agencies are not categorized as essential services, this has created a major hurdle in our efforts in keeping an eye or check on these illegal activities. Due to restrictions on people movement, industry is unable to do a reality check in the markets and is also not able to get an on-ground investigation done through its agencies to be able to pass on relevant information to the police. Sample procurement continues to be another challenge in the whole scheme of things. While on the civil side, the courts have swiftly risen to the occasion and are granting injunctions against infringers, the industry continues to face the challenge of executing these orders in the absence of appointment of court commissioners and assistance of police commissioner, police officials directed by the court. To add to the on-ground challenges, we have also seen that counterfeit sales have mushroomed on online and social media platforms. While the industry has fairly succeeded in takedown initiatives with the help of service providers, tracing and tracking action against actual sellers pose a great challenge during this COVID period. Even as lockdown relaxations will be announced, the genuine businesses will take some time to get on their feet and serve consumer needs, while counterfeiters will continue to take advantage of the situation. Another concern, as rightly pointed out by the earlier speaker, is that once the trade channels open up, there will be an influx of counterfeit imports, especially from China, which is already on its feet. As restrictions during COVID and post-COVID period will continue for some time, the border enforcement will be affected, and this will entail seepage of counterfeits into the domestic markets. Another increasingly alarming concern, which again was pointed out by the earlier speakers, is that fraudsters have grabbed this opportunity to commit cybercrime, like registering fake domain names to dupe consumers or other phishing activities. Given these challenges and the fact that counterfeiters are evolving with speed to adapt to the situation, there is a need for enforcement agencies and the industry to step up the existing enforcement mechanisms. While we have sufficiently robust laws and enforcement around it, the implementation of the same continues to be a challenge, which has only increased with the COVID situation. For example, Even if a brand owner has information regarding any such illegal activity, the biggest challenge during this COVID or lockdown situation is having someone to go down to the police station to file the complaint and follow through on this. The challenges around enforcement continues to put brand owners under severe hardship. Therefore, some suggestions to deal with the situation. Since COVID is an exceptional situation, there needs to be a mechanism where police can take cognizance of a complaint raised by the aggrieved person, which could be either the brand owner or a consumer, through means of emails or calls without requiring formal filing of complaint, since these illegal activities have far-reaching ramifications on the economy and its people. And please bear with me, I'm only giving the suggestion only during COVID because it is an exceptional situation and during the lockdown situation. This is not something that I'm proposing to be implemented across all times. Existing laws also need to be leveraged. Like I said, we have no dearth of robust laws. The brand owners and consumers also need to be aware of various laws that can be used to set up the criminal machinery in action. For example, while there is the trademark law, while there is copyright law, we all know that there are certain challenges around it. So therefore, you know, what are the other laws that these brand owners or consumers can leverage? For example, little is known about how the provisions of, say, PMLA, Money Laundering Act, or the Gunda Act, or the Consumer Protection Act can be invoked, and in which situations to curb these kind of, illicit activity. Trade bodies like FICCI can therefore conduct training sessions, not only for the law enforcement machinery, but also for brand owners and consumers on these areas, so that they know what their rights are and how they can seek the remedy. On teaming up and collaborative work, police officials need to collaborate with state authorities like FDA, Excise, GST authorities, as these counterfeits constitute offences under DCA, FSSAI, Excise and GST as well. From a perspective of strengthening collaborative efforts to tackle this ongoing menace collectively, I have a few suggestions. Brand owners and police officials could collaborate to create a database of such offenders, and especially repeat offenders, which would help police to take suo-motu cognizance of offences under relevant laws. Police and other authorities can also have a joint database of these offenders for collective actions and seamless sharing of intelligence. So like I said earlier, the FDA, GST authorities and all, between police and all these authorities, you could have a mechanism of intelligence sharing. Also, better collaboration and seamless collaboration between police in different jurisdictions to share the intelligence. For example, like I said, the major problem is jurisdictional issues. Like, you know, if a crime has been committed in one area, the police station within that jurisdiction is the right forum where the complaint can be filed. But this creates a lot of hassle. So if there can be a seamless mechanism where within the, you know, if the complaint is filed in one jurisdiction, within the police system, you are able to allocate that to the right jurisdiction, so that the police does not lose time on investigative actions. So for these purposes, AI tools can be considered, and I'm sure Tanmay is there on the panel, so he will talk about various tools that can help the officials on this. On other aspects, we are seeing that the government is giving a lot of relaxations because of the COVID and the lockdown situation, and therefore we could consider some relaxations in the ways of working during the lockdown period. For example, when a complainant has a valid authorization from the brand owner, police should not refuse to register the FIR based on such complaint, as representatives of brand owners may not be able to come to the police station to file the complaint personally. You could probably put in place an alternate system where you can hold the brand owner responsible to provide relevant authorization or come down later when the situation normalizes. But during the lockdown period, probably the police could work out some kind of a mechanism where if a person is authorized by brand owner, they can go and file the complaint on behalf of the brand owner. The second is exemption from providing documentary or other evidence in case of counterfeiting intelligence. Now, where there is accurate information or reliable information that there is a counterfeiting activity going on, then there should be some relaxation given in terms of documentation. Like, for example, you would need a copyright deed of assignment or, you know, some other proof of ownership. So probably, again, you could put the brand owner, on some kind of a condition or indemnity to provide these documents in support of their complaint at a later stage. But during lockdown, because speed is of essence and because action needs to be taken against these counterfeiters during lockdown, especially because they are doing illicit activities in respect of essential goods, I think these kind of things can be dispensed of or at least relaxed. There could also be a designated email or Twitter handle where such complaints relating to counterfeits can be filed, and within the police system, again, you can allocate it to your right jurisdiction. This again will, you know, aid in taking swift actions without having to resort to all procedural formalities. Then again, where the case would eventually travel to court, probably the judiciary also needs to balance applicability of existing laws with the action that has been taken in public interest, like where there has been some relaxation while documents may not have been taken at that time. Probably the court judiciary also needs to consider it and balance it with the public interest at that point in time. Another thing is probably the relevant authorities could issue a circular relaxing operability of certain provisions of existing laws to enable the working of criminal enforcement in larger public interest. Like, for example, we know there are provisions under the Trademark Act, which while it gives the police officers power of taking cognizance of the offense, it prevents them from taking action without fulfilling certain preconditions. So therefore, if there could be some kind of relaxation during this period, because we know that, like, I'm reiterating the same thing that, you know, time is of essence, and during this time it is very, it becomes very essential to curb these kind of activities, and it is it assumes greater significance during the COVID and lockdown period as compared to even other periods. Therefore, something like this could probably be looked at. So these are a few of my suggestions, and I would like to rest my case. Thank you.
Thank you, Vijayalakshmi, for a very detailed description on your suggestions. I'll now request Ms. Dhwani Rao, Senior Legal Counsel, South Asia Region of Nestle, to please make her comments.
Thank you, Swati. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for providing this platform to allow us to speak and bring in our perspective as from the industry perspective. Before I start with anything, the disadvantage of being the last speaker from the industry panel seems like that you have almost covered everything, Viji. I have very little to probably
add.
No, but I think it was very insightful, and I really appreciate coming up with a genuine list of do's and don'ts and should-be's from the industry's perspective, and I would probably not have anything extraordinary to add other than that. But just as a perspective for everyone, there are a few things that I thought I would just bring to everyone's attention. Just to begin with, if the fisherman is not able to go to the sea to fish, they are busy knitting the nets. As much as it applies to us, it applies to all the counterfeiters. According to the global study that we had done internally to figure out what's the real insight of counterfeit during these times, it came across that the likelihood of buying counterfeit is going to be higher in these times. People at large have been financially impacted due to COVID crisis, and consumers are likely to be tempted to switch to cheaper products. And anyone offering them the same brand in cheaper price, the tilt is likely to shift. So we are already alarmed and are aware of this fact, and something that we should always be insightful of, that the likelihood of counterfeit is more to come and will happen. If not in some of the spaces, there will be those spaces as well that will be filled up with counterfeit products. At the same time, we are also seeing a shift in terms of online buying, which is becoming rampant. The small grocery stores have also started to offer e-selling, which means they are easily able to push counterfeit. Now, they will not be certainly be able to be as compliant and following the same compliance standards like the biggies like Amazon and similar such platforms are offering to ensure that there is no counterfeit, but they will be more tempted to sell counterfeit, push counterfeit, and as a result of which, there is also a huge likelihood of having counterfeit in that space. So with that context and perspective, I thought some of the ground issues that we are facing in these times is that there are lack of informers, because there are migrant workers. These are the migrant workers who were essentially our eyes and ears to any kind of fishy activity that were happening on ground level. So these movements are actually impacting us as an industry who were otherwise getting this kind of information from a lot of ground workers. So there's a lack of knowledge over there, and the investigation is at a lag. Which Viji has again covered over here, requesting if at all we could step up and we could do something more to ensure that the investigation or the eyes and the ears or the ground level is still on, if not through anyone else, but through the police officials or people who are already on ground and are monitoring other activities. At the same time, if you look at the court activities, it has slowed down a bit, though I'm not very not optimistic about it. I'm fairly optimistic about it because there is a lot of activity still happening, and if at all there is a genuine case of counterfeit which has been identified, then they are looking into the matters and are passing relevant orders. But the point comes when they appoint a court commissioner, what happens next? Are the court commissioners rightful to say we are scared and we are not willing to go ahead and do this because we are worried about our safety and precaution? As a company and as an industry and as brand owners, should we step up? And we should, I think, should step up to offer them everything that would give them the comfort to take actions at the ground level during these times. While it is temporary, but I think this will be a longish temporary that we will face, and we all accept that this will be there for some time now. So as a result of which, we cannot park that issue. We have to deal with upfront, and if at all, court commissioners or police officials or anybody who is there on the ground working on any kind of counterfeit raid or anything like that, I really request everyone, whosoever is listening, that in case you find and identify some leads like that, do pass on. As far as safety, security is concerned, I think the brand will be more than willing to offer to address some genuine ask like PPE kits, precaution like masks, sanitizers, etc., which the brand owners and the industry will be willing to offer in case you are taking such actions on the ground level. At the same time, I mean, on the practical level, if you look at it, if you are doing the raids, and if anybody who has been part of the raids, they would know how is it difficult to maintain the social distancing. So while we would go in a limited group to go and conduct the raid, but what happens at the ground level are that people are bound to circle around, to gather around and everything. In case such kind of activities are happening, how is it as police or as court commissioners or as brands and as lawyers, how are you going to ensure that there is social distancing maintained even during those raid times? And as I say, this is not going to be temporary, it's going to be long term. So we have to start thinking about it from the ground level as to what are the things that we should be doing once we are put to action, and how are we going to be implementing while maintaining the social distancing. I mean, I'm aware that some of the states like UP and many other states have ensured that there should be a maximum group of 5 people at one place. If that be the case, how are you still going to be conducting any kind of active actions around it? So these are some ground level issues. If and when, if we have the right kind of information, and if at all we identify counterfeit, and if there is any kind of action that happens, what are the some practical issues that you would otherwise face, and something that we should all be aware of as part of this whole unit. As far as criminal raids are concerned, Vijay has broadly covered everything and all the asks. But as a brand, I do feel there is merit in making it as automated as possible, as virtual as possible, reducing the amount of interaction of people to having to come them to bring on board that there is a counterfeit availability and there is alignment on raid action. Okay. I hear some disturbance, I'm sure. So, just at the ground level also, I mean, when the criminal raids are happening, and if at all we happen to approach any of the police wings and the economic offense wings, there is a genuine requirement to make it as electronic, as virtual in nature. Maybe there should be some preset number of people or email IDs, which are their registered email IDs, basis which they know that it is only coming from a genuine brand or a genuine owner and not some arbitrary person who is just wanting to file a complaint. So a set of registered users should be there with them so that if there is any complaint coming from any of those registered user brand owners, then in that case, they should sort of give a little bit of more weight, and instead of getting into too much of ask and everything, probably start working on that kind of information. And as and when whatever information is required, it can be all virtually provided, at least to bring them on alignment on how and if there is a counterfeit availability and what is it that they should be doing. At the same time, confidentiality of such information. So if anybody has insight or such kind of information, how is it that you do not pass on to many people? Because that's another thing that we also face at a practical level, certainly not at the higher level, but at the practical level, at a lower level, we do feel that if there is any information passed, there is very, it's very difficult to contain that information. It passes from one to the other. So if anybody who is in charge of having recording of these kind of complaints on a virtual format or an email format, the confidentiality aspect needs to be reiterated with such kind of individuals. At the same time, submitting of documents, as again Vijay had covered, that have some flexibility in terms of copyright registration, trademark registrations, food laws, any other manufacturing list, distributor list. These are some typical asks that we typically have whenever we file a complaint. In that case, if there could be a little lag or just information passing is a little difficult, then ensure that it will eventually pass through. But basis whatever information is available, if there is some action points that can be developed or that can be taken care of. So these are some of the things. At the same time, I mean, I conclude that as an industry, we can have a huge bucket list of ask over and above what you all have been otherwise providing. And I think the police and everybody is doing a fantastic job. At the same time, even the investigators who are continuing to keep that vigilance and keep that eye from whatever limited resources they have. I also understand from investigators' point of view that they have lack of informers. They have lack of people who would be giving them this right kind of information to be converted into something substantial to pass it on to the brand owners. And to the lawyers as well, who are still doing all those work for us in case there is any kind of tip available or any kind of actions available. I have seen a lot of lawyers just really working hard towards at least getting it done, be it from filing the case, be it taking it to the court level or arranging for such kind of raids. Obviously, for quite some time, there was a little restrictive activity going on when, even when it came to raid. But these days, for the past couple of weeks, I have seen that there is some activity that's happening around in that space also, and that the lawyers are really coming around in terms of how it should happen, what should happen. And there are these amazing ideas that I also receive from them as to how we can still conduct the raids or take action despite having limited resources and at the same time taking the precautions in place. So That's the message from all industry and even from our side, that one thing that you all should be all rest assured is that the industry and the brand is ready to provide you as much safety, as much security, as much protection when it comes to this particular COVID crisis is concerned. But other than that, also, if you move to a level wherein these things are not required, but you know, these are some genuine asks that you can even give to the industry and tell them, these are the things that we need when we are conducting or taking actions on behalf of you at the ground level. So that's that from my end. These are some practical aspects other than for what Vijay had otherwise covered. I'll be happy to receive inputs. I'll be happy to receive information. And thank you one and all. Thank you, Mr. O.P. Mishra, for doing what you're doing. Thank you, everyone, for doing what they are doing. And we are all glad to be participating in this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dhwani. Thank you for sharing your practical and ground level activities which are required. Our next speaker on the panel is Mr. Tanmay Jaswal, founder and director, CheckFake Brand Protection Solutions. Tanmay will briefly take us through on how technologies can be leveraged to battle illicit operators. Tanmay?
Yeah. Thank you, Swati. Let me just share my screen so that I can take you through the presentation that I have. Just one second. Please let me know if you can see my screen.
Yes, we can.
Yeah, Tanmay.
Okay, great. Right. So thank you. And it's a pleasure to be here amongst such august company. And thank you for Fiki Cascade for inviting us and for all the panelists for their brilliant perspectives so far on how we can fight counterfeiting and some of the issues that are being faced as we go through this COVID-19 pandemic. My name is Tanmay Jaiswal. I am the founder of CheckFake. I'll talk about the role of emerging technology in tackling the impact COVID-19 will have on counterfeits. As you can see, we are trying to follow all precautions. Even our logos are, wearing masks nowadays, and we're all working from home. But that's not really it as far as the impact of COVID-19 is concerned. Very quickly, let me first take you through who we are. We are specialists in end-to-end brand protection. So not just anti-counterfeiting technology, which is what most players do. Our focus is on enabling ease of authentication, whatever the technology you are using, automating brand protection workflows, and really driving market intelligence. Our single-minded objective is to directly increase our clients' revenues by implementing an effective brand protection program. We recommend a three-step process to draw back revenue from counterfeits and lookalikes. Step one is to invest in a strong anti-counterfeiting technology, which helps anyone easily tell the difference between fake and real. This should not be looked at as a cost, but more as an investment that gives you returns. The second step is to communicate widely how to verify genuine to all stakeholders, or a subset of them, depending on the brand's preference. Otherwise, any investment in the technology is worthless. And the third step, which a lot of the panelists talked about, is to take strong deterrent enforcement action. What really helps here, and this is what I'm going to talk about a little more, is to invest in a market intelligence system that gives the brand eyes on the market on where the problem is. A lot of these, let's talk a little bit about the impact that COVID-19 is having or likely to have in the long term. A lot of these are already covered by some of the panelists. There are five broad trends that we think are going to be having a longer term impact. And this is what experts are talking about as well. One big one, obviously, is the shift to online shopping. Still low in percentage terms, it is likely to grow explosively as customers get used to the behavior they have adopted during lockdown. The implication, of course, as people have pointed out, is a higher risk of counterfeits, as distribution of fakes is really easy online, despite the best effort of marketplaces. We also see brands moving to more local supply chains. This preference of local suppliers is because brands want to guard themselves against the kind of supply disruptions which they don't want to become a business continuity threat in the future. The impact is likely going to be higher prices, since global supply chains are more efficient and economical, and that creates a window for counterfeiters to get in with their so-called discounts. The third big issue, which we have already seen, is legitimate supply footprints shrinking for many brands due to lockdown difficulties. This has opened up the field for counterfeiters to fulfill the pent-up demand, as there's a frenzy of customers, panic buying, and so on. So while this will slowly taper off, it is still something of immediate concern. We are also facing the biggest economic challenge in our history, with record unemployment and pay cuts across. The resulting loss of purchasing power is likely to make customers very price sensitive. Again, is an opportunity for counterfeits to get in with their discounts. And finally, especially for the consumer goods industry, white goods and automobiles and so on, non-essential purchases we feel are going to be postponed. And brands in these sectors have to focus on protecting their consumables business, so that revenue losses to counterfeits there can be curbed and profit lines can be maintained. So what is the solution? We did a scan of what industry leaders in the brand protection space are actually doing and what can we learn from them. They focus on capturing 100% of enforcement leads from multiple sources, such as sales team, other employees, distributors, customers, and so on. Generating these leads is facilitated by anti-counterfeiting technology, which makes it quick for users to identify fakes at the moment of truth when you hold the product in your hand. In recent times, online enforcement has also become increasingly important and will be more so in the post-COVID era. Counterfeiters are targeting most of the popular e-commerce sites as well as social media, like Dhwani had pointed out. Leading brands typically partner with a specialist online enforcement organization which uses AI and automation tools for effective identification and takedown of market list of counterfeit listings. Reporting has to be something that brings everything together. Reports should be standardized for ease of evaluation, and it's important to have everything integrated so that it makes it far easier and productive for the brand protection team to act quickly and efficiently. The team can also get a longer term view by analyzing past incidents and trends and providing strategic insights and alerts. The current reality in most organizations is that leads get missed as multiple stakeholders are using multiple channels to feedback any intelligence they get from the market to multiple people within the organization. Typically, even the information they are feeding back is incomplete and non-standard. So it's usually a nightmare of a workflow and almost impossible to keep track. As a result, valuable leads are missed because either it gets through the cracks or the quality of the lead is poor. Typically, in organizations, we have worked with 65 to 70% of enforcement leads and follow-up actions are lost like this. And response time of the brand protection team is also slow due to the manual process of managing such leads. What is needed is a more streamlined system that can standardize evidence being reported and keeps everything in a single repository, which makes for easy lead management. Lead management is also an important consideration. You know, current reality is that if a lead is reported from the market, managing the lead is all manually done in terms of next actions. It makes it a cumbersome process. Tracking of the status of the lead is really difficult, and retrieval after a point, because there is no central repository, is almost impossible. Also, the haphazard workflows, given that brands are using multiple agencies, can be standardized. This makes it easier for management reporting by consolidating all agencies' outputs automatically. Many brands and agencies have also pointed to the trust deficit in investigations. Now, there are a lot of professional investigative agencies out there, but this trust deficit makes it difficult for brands to trust whatever actions that are happening on the ground. And this is also something through validated actions in the market can be taken care of. Finally, let's not leave behind the important role that quick identification of fakes in the marketplace takes. Investigation time can be significantly reduced by the use of technology in allowing easy verification and reporting. Enforcement leads can also be significantly increased if more stakeholders like distributors, retailers, and customers are roped in the task of identifying fakes. We try to bring this all together into a single product. It provides an end-to-end management of a brand's anti-counterfeiting program by enabling quick identification of fakes, capturing all leads, and a streamlined lead management system that results in validated investigations and more successful enforcement actions. So we have three distinct modules: lead capture, investigator, and authentication. Lead capture allows any customer, channel member, or internal staff authorized by the brand to report a counterfeit incident. High quality standardized evidence is captured and sent to the brand protection team in real time. Investigator allows validation of third-party investigator actions in the field and automating the workflow of lead management and reporting of enforcement actions. And CheckFake authentication allows users to easily verify genuine. It can incorporate multiple anti-counterfeiting technologies from different vendors. It is also a useful training tool for staff, investigators, enforcement authorities on how to identify a fake product in the market, because you can readily access it through the smartphone. So as you can see from this slide, we have a lead capture app, which can be used by customers, channel members, and internal team. All of this flows into the lead management system, which allows the brand protection team to take action in real time. A separate investigator app validates all investigative actions, which are also available to the brand. Not only that, the online enforcement tools are also integrated in the same dashboard, providing the brand with a comprehensive view of their anti-counterfeiting program. It's a sophisticated tool for management reporting as well, allowing brands to keep track of their investment and ROI. The automation, the workflow automation here always allows the brand as well as the agency partners to keep track of where a lead is in the entire process. Let me show you a few dashboards that are available. I'll just quickly run through them. Through these interactive dashboards, brands can review the overall health of the business with these heat maps. They can play around with specific time periods or individual geographies. They can drill down into that, or brands right down to SKU level. They can review trends of what is happening as far as reporting of counterfeits is concerned, and individually evaluate each incident that comes through. There are also specific views on enforcement actions as well, which give you, you know, the status of raids, you know, open leads, and how many have been converted into enforcement actions, total amount of seized goods, total units sold, total units seized, et cetera, et cetera. So we are the first in the world really to offer a comprehensive counterfeit lead capture tool, which has full workflow automation to back it up. We are also the first to offer verified investigative actions to brand owners. And our repository that you see here allows easy management of enforcement leads, as well as strategic insights and a real-time view of the health of your brand protection program. So in summary, you know, these 10-step process, we believe, have the potential to claw back about 50% of the brand's revenue loss to counterfeits. Invest in a strong anti-counterfeiting technology, widely communicate how to verify genuine, enable quick and easy authentication, ensure 100% offline counterfeit lead capture with high quality evidence, partner with a strong online enforcement agency for quick identification and takedown of fake product listings, with reputed investigative agencies to determine source of counterfeits, agencies which can give you transparency and visibility of their actions, manage counterfeit leads end-to-end quickly and efficiently, establish strong relationships with enforcement agencies, with the police, with customs, and so on, partner with reputed legal firms to take deterrent enforcement action, and work with industry association to drive communication on why buy genuine and how to verify genuine, besides policy advocacy, because these are areas where brands struggle to have an individual voice, but collectively within the industry association, they can really make a big impact in terms of communicating this to the market. So that's really it from my side. I hope this overview of an emerging technology which can tackle counterfeits in the post-COVID era has been useful to you. This is the end of my presentation, so over to you, Swati.
Thank you, Tanmay. I think Swati has lost the connection. Swati, are you there? I would request Mr. Mishra to take one or two questions. So we have certain questions from the speakers, or if you have 5 minutes, we can take the questions, please. Dr. Mishra?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so I will read out the question to you. So this is a question from Mr. Raghav, where he is saying, very informative session. He's from Remfree and Sagar, who's asking that we've been conducting raids across India for various clients engaged in different sectors. However, we have experienced that conducting raids is a little difficult in India as compared to other jurisdictions, especially down south. So he requests your comments on this, sir.
See, it will not be proper for me to comment about the response of the police organizations of other states. But what I would like to say that a point which has emerged in all the speakers is a better coordination and synergy between all the stakeholders. And when we are talking about stakeholders, police is also a very important stakeholder, but there are other stakeholders too. But as far as the question of Delhi is concerned, we are very receptive. I have just heard some good suggestions from some of the speakers also. And they are really very important to make the enforcement system very friendly. You see, my own view is that whenever we are trying to fight the menace of organized crime like this or any other criminal activity, those who are committing this crime, they are better organized than those people who are trying to fight it. And there are many issues for that. So we have to actually come on a same platform. And if the issue which has been pointed out by the gentleman, it could be reflected before respective law enforcing agency. But let me also tell you that there is a difference between the enforcement of law related to copyright or trademark in India and things which happen across. I mean, there is definitely a difference. So that also needs to be seen that perspective.
All right. Thank you, sir. And this is a question from Mr. Anil Chibbar, who is requesting your comment on that in the present scenario, as a service provider, can we get some sort of written approval from the law enforcement or the MHA to conduct investigations and enforcements during the lockdown?
I think these are again issues. You see, there are many things which are happening now is also undergoing under a very broad statutory provisions. I mean, whatever measures have been initiated, they are basically being taken in the format of a particular law which is existing there. This is a new suggestion which has come, and instantly to react to it that it can be accorded, I think will not be proper. This again will have to, because under unprecedented situations or COVID-19, we have to be also very careful about practices which we try to adopt it. You know, there are people, there are even those people who are involved in counterfeiting and other things. They also take advantage of many such measures which come, despite this having some kind of a friendly approach towards other people. But seeking online approval or seeking instant approval, I think this requires, perspective on this. I think instantly it won't be. One has to see what kind of an approval is coming, what are the implications for this and all. And after proper examination, only such things can be processed.
So the final question from Sanjoli Bhatt from Syngenta. She is asking that with relation to illicit trade in agrochemical industry, apart from enforcing trademark right Insecticide Act, how well can we ensure on ground action using alternate legal route, what is the support from the law enforcement authorities in conducting raids?
You see, any illegal activity can be curbed only through a proper legal backup. You need to have a proper law in place which takes into account something which is considered legal. There are many things illegal, but if there is no proper law to control that, regulate that, then there are issues about that. Now, to in fact get information on all this, it is better to have local level intelligence. And it was very rightly pointed out by the former special commissioner that when we are talking about law, those laws related to counterfeiting and a trademark act, they are not as effective as it should be. I mean, something which used to be non-bailable before has become bailable because the quantum of punishment is not more than 7 years and all that in that. So you need to have very effective laws also in place and laws with very stringent provisions. I mean, I will give you a very good example of NDPS Act. I mean, NDPS Act became a draconian law. It had some very strong provisions which did help the law enforcement agency in curbing the menace of the narcotics drugs in this country.
Thank you, sir. Is Mr. Bijoy Mishra there? I cannot see him because he wanted to make a comment. I don't think he's there. In that case, I'll request Mr. Deepchand to please conclude the session.
Kashyapa, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Thank you very much, Kashyapa. It is my pleasure to conclude the webinar. It was really very interesting and very knowledgeable discussion. On my behalf and on behalf of Fikki Cascade, I would like to thank Dr. O.P. Mishra for making such interesting and very knowledgeable comments and presentation. And more than that, it was, he made it possible to attend this webinar despite his being very, very busy in this time period of COVID-19. And more than, I would also like to thank here the Commissioner of Police Delhi, Mr. S.N. Srivastav, whom I made a request that you that he nominate Dr. O.P. Mishra, so that he is a relevant person and he will be able to do justice with the webinar subject. And I thank the CP as well as Dr. O.P. Mishra, the Joint Commissioner, EOW Cell. I would like to thank Mr. Anil Rajput for giving a very good overview of the issue and providing us an opportunity to discuss this issue on this webinar. I would like to thank all the participants on the webinar, especially thanking the representatives of the industry who came out with some real issues they are facing on the ground, and the discussion was possible on how to resolve these issues in their day-to-day practical thing. Ultimately, it is the coordination between the law enforcement agency and the investigating officers and the officers of the industry. With their coordination only, it is possible to catch the criminals. I'm sure FICCI Cascade would continue its program of capacity building program with Delhi Police and other states, and in the near future, we'll be holding more such programs, webinars, and exchanging views. Thank you very much, Dr. O.P. Mishra, once again, and all the participants. Thank you. Keep safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you all. Thank you for joining us. And we look forward to seeing you again. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, FICCI, for inviting me.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, Mishra ji.
Nice, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much.